Well, hi, friends. My name's Matthew Dowling, preaching minister at the Plymouth Church of Christ, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to my study today for our next lesson in the Holy Spirit Seminar. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I invite you to open them up to Jude 20, where we're going to begin today, and this is lesson 15 of the Holy Spirit Seminar, titled Praying, Returning Thanks, and Worshiping in the Holy Spirit. You know, dear friends, we begin in Jude 20 because it's one of two of the most deeply significant passages in the Bible on the subject of the Holy Spirit and the topic of prayer. And we bring those things to the forefront today because we want to think about what it means to pray and to return thanks to God and to worship in the Holy Spirit. Jude chapter 20 says this, "But you, dear friends, build yourselves up in your most holy faith and pray in the Holy Spirit." Let's turn now to the second of those two passages I mentioned, this time Ephesians 6 and verse 18, where the Apostle Paul writes this, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints." We see in these verses an acknowledgement of the important role that the Holy Spirit plays in our Christian lives, particularly when it comes to us as praying Christians. And the first major point I want to consider with you in this lesson today is that the Holy Spirit, we're told, guides believers in prayer. That's an important role of the Holy Spirit. And you know, when we go back to the lifetime of Jesus, we realize that the disciples, they did not know how to pray as they ought to. And so they came to Jesus while he was still here on earth, and they wanted to learn, how is it that we are to pray? In fact, in Luke 11 and verse 1, they actually came with that question to the Lord Jesus, and they said, "Lord, teach us to pray." Well, you know, just as those disciples in the first century, we in the 21st century need to be taught by Christ, by God, how to pray. We don't know how to pray as we ought to. Maybe you've experienced this before. You don't know what to pray for. You don't know how to ask for what you need according to God's will. But the truth is, according to Scripture, that there is one who's always at hand, one who always is able to help us. And we're told that in John 14, verses 16 through 17, that we have a divine resource to help us in prayer. And it turns out that this divine resource knows what we should pray for. In fact, the Bible teaches that this resource is the Holy Spirit himself. In fact, the Bible says that he teaches us to pray. In fact, true prayer, as it's defined by the Bible, is prayer in the Spirit. That is to say, true prayer is prayer that the Holy Spirit inspires and directs. And we're told in the Bible that the prayer in which the Holy Spirit leads us is the prayer that is in accordance with God's will. We're told that in Romans 8, verse 27. In fact, we're told that when we ask anything according to the will of God, we know that he will hear us and even grant us the things that we ask if we pray within his will. The Apostle John reiterates that truth in 1 John 5, verses 14 through 15. And you know, we may know it is ours at the moment when we pray, just as surely as we know it afterward when we have it in our actual possession. If we are praying in the will of God, we know that we will receive it. But of course, I can anticipate your question in this very moment. How can we know the will of God when we pray? And there are several ways, the first and most important of which is we can know God's will by what is written in his word, right? All the promises in the Bible are sure, and if God promises us anything in his word, we may be sure that it is his will to give that thing to us. We need to know the word of God for this reason. But you know, even as I say that, dear friends, I realize there are many things that we need which are not specifically promised in the Word. And still, even in that case, it is our privilege to know the will of God. But how can we know it if it's not explicitly promised in the Word? The answer is the Holy Spirit, you see. This is how the Spirit is involved in our prayer life. It is the work of the Holy Spirit to teach us God's will and to lead us out in prayer along the lines of God's will, okay? And so that's one of the reasons why the Holy Spirit is so important to the believer. Now, there are some believers who will object to the Christian doctrine of prayer. They say that it teaches that we can go to God in our ignorance and actually change His will and subject His wisdom to our ignorance, as if God can be moved in that way. But to respond to that, I would say that's not the Christian doctrine of prayer at all. That's not how prayer works. The Christian doctrine of prayer is that it really is the believer's privilege to be taught by the Spirit of God Himself, okay? And to know what the will of God is, and not to ask for the things that our foolishness would prompt us to ask for, but rather to ask for things in the never-erring Spirit of God. That's what the Christian doctrine of prayer does. The Spirit of God prompts us to ask for what is in God's will. And that is why we say that true prayer is prayer in the Spirit, you see. That is, the prayer which the Spirit inspires and directs is true Christian prayer. And so, to put it more simply, when we come into God's presence, we need to recognize our needs. We need to understand that God can provide. We have to realize that we, compared to God, are very ignorant, and He knows what's best for us. And we should pray as led by the Spirit. We realize we have an inability to pray perfectly, and so the Spirit will help us and teach us to pray. And in that realization, we just cast our concerns upon the Spirit. Spirit, help me. Help me to say the things to God. I encourage you to pray in that way, by depending on the Spirit, rather than just rushing headlong into prayer. You need to stop and be mindful that there's a tendency not to pray in the Spirit, okay? You need to stop and be mindful that we need God's help. And so I would say, friends, to start your prayer time with an acknowledgement of your need for the Spirit and an acknowledgement that you're going to need the Spirit's help as you pray. And you know, what a comfort it is to know that the Spirit's going to help us. In fact, the Bible teaches that there are things, longings even, that the Spirit places in our hearts, which are often, too deep for words, too deep for really our own understanding, too deep apparently, for clear and definite comprehension by us. And so the Spirit helps us to bring those longings and to bring those concerns before the Lord. And that's why Paul says in Romans 8:26, this comforting promise. He says, "The Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express." This is an acknowledgement that God Himself must search the hearts of His people. And as God the Father communicates with the mind of the Spirit in these unutterable longings which are within us, deep communicates to deep, okay? God does know what is in the mind of the Spirit. He does know what these Spirit-given longings are, which we cannot put into words. And even if we're not able to do that, these longings are according to the will of God, and God will grant them. And you see, dear friends, the Holy Spirit is a tremendous resource. It is in this way that it comes to pass that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. That's what Paul says in Ephesians 3 and verse 20. And so this is a tremendous comfort. You know, there are other times when the Spirit's leadings are so clear that we are able to pray with the Spirit and with understanding also. Paul tells us that in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 15. But we need to always remember that it is the Spirit that distinctly leads us in our prayer. And so that's our first point this morning. The Holy Spirit guides us as believers in prayer. And this brings us to a second major thought together, which is that the Bible teaches the Holy Spirit inspires the believer and will guide us as believers in thanksgiving, okay? Let's turn now to Ephesians 5, verses 18 through 20, and let's see how Scripture talks about the fact that the Spirit inspires us and guides us in thanksgiving. Paul writes there, "Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." And so notice here, not only does the Holy Spirit teach us to pray, He also teaches us to give thanks. He makes us a grateful people. He tells us and helps us to be people of gratitude. You know, one of the most prominent characteristics of the Spirit-filled life is thanksgiving. It makes us a grateful people. You might remember on the day of Pentecost when the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke as the Spirit enabled them. We heard them telling of the wonderful works of God with thanksgiving in their hearts. We read about that in Acts chapter 2, verse 4 and verse 11. That was a characteristic of the early disciples. And today, when any believer is filled with the Holy Spirit, they always become filled with thanksgiving and with prayer. In fact, the Bible teaches that true thanksgiving is to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Holy Spirit. And so you see, we're drawn into the life of the triune God as the Spirit inspires us and guides us in thanksgiving. Well, this brings us to our third and final major point in this 15th lesson of the Holy Spirit seminar. That is, the Bible's teaching that the Holy Spirit inspires worship on the part of the believer. As I record this lesson this morning, it's Sunday morning, the Lord's Day, and shortly I'm going to go into the sanctuary here at the Plymouth Church of Christ and to lead our people in worship. And we know that I'm not the ultimate leader of worship. It is the Holy Spirit which inspires worship on the part of the believer. Let's read together in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 3 about this. Paul says in that passage that it is we, that is Christians, it is we, the people of God, who are the circumcision. We, notice, who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. Prayer can be worship. Thanksgiving can be worship. But they're really part of a larger thing, which is worship. And worship is no small thing. Worship's a big thing, okay? Worship is the definite act of the creature in relation to God, okay? It's an act that we do. One of the reasons why we assemble on the Lord's Day every week, as God has instructed us to do, is to actually give the Lord worship, okay? And worship is bowing down before God in adoring acknowledgement, and even in contemplation of God and the perfection of his being. And so what we're doing when we come in awe and reverence before God to acknowledge his perfections and his attributes is we're doing worship. Does that help us to think about worship? I think so. It also helps us to distinguish between private devotion, where prayer and thanksgiving are a part, and the larger congregational worship in which prayer and thanksgiving are a part, but we're doing something more than just that. Someone has said this about these acts. They say, in our prayers, we are taken up with our needs. In our thanksgiving, we are taken up with our blessings. But in our worship, we are taken up with God himself. And so worship is its own thing. There is no true and acceptable worship except that which the Holy Spirit prompts and directs. Let's look together in the Bible to get a sense of this in John chapter 4, verses 23 and 24. This is Jesus speaking to the woman at the well. And listen to what he says about worship. He says, yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kinds of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. You know, this is an important verse, and it points out a challenge that we have as believers who live in the world. We often, because we live in this earthly existence, we want to worship by the strength of our own flesh. And the flesh, as it's called by the Bible, kind of seeks to intrude into every area of our lives. The flesh has its worship as well as its lust, the pride of the eyes, the pride of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of those things, as John talks about in 1 John. These intrude in our life. But here's the thing. We can't really truly worship God by our own strength, by our own blessings. That's fleshly worship. And the worship which the flesh prompts is not acceptable to God. There is folly in attempting to worship God in ways that we think is right. We have to come to God's Word and understand what He means. The fact is, not all earnest worship being done is worship in the Spirit. A Christian can be very honest and very earnest in worship and still not have submitted themselves to the guidance of the Holy Spirit in the matter of worship. And so worship can be in the flesh. We need the Spirit's help in worship. And so this is important. To worship the way God desires us to worship, we must have no confidence in the flesh, as Paul says in Philippians 3, verse 3. That is, we must recognize the utter inability of our fleshly natures, that is, our natural self as contrasted to the divine Spirit that dwells in us as believers. We need the Spirit to worship acceptably. And we must also realize the danger that the flesh will intrude itself into our worship, okay? And for that reason, we always need to be checking that we're worshiping in the Spirit as we gather on the Lord's day. And we need to depend on the Holy Spirit and His work in us, not only in our daily lives, but in our worship lives. His help to help us to know God's Word, to pray it, to thank Him and to worship, and all else we are able to do. We need to depend on the Spirit's help to do that. And that's what it means to worship by the Spirit. So this has been our 15th lesson in the Holy Spirit seminar, praying, giving thanks, and worshiping in the Holy Spirit. I appreciate you joining me today. Lord willing, we'll be back next time for our 16th lesson in the Holy Spirit seminar. These are the last handfuls of lessons in this series, and we're going to be talking about the Holy Spirit sending people out to do works of service. And so join me next time for that, and I pray in the meantime that you will be blessed and be a blessing to others. God bless you, dear friends.